Hello friends, today's topic is other provisions under the topic of income from other sources. In this topic, we will be studying taxability of other provisions of section 56(2), wherein taxability of winnings from lottery, taxability of interest from enhanced compensation, compensation received from compulsory acquisition of the property, income from hire of machinery, building, plant and machinery, and so on and so forth, which are basically covered under subsection 2 of section 56. So friends, let's start with the other provisions of subsection 2 of section 56. Next clause is clause 1b, which deals with casual income in a way, winnings from lotteries, crossword puzzles, horse races winnings, card games, and any other game of gambling, betting, etc. So, if an SSE has income from lotteries, puzzles, horse races, and similar kind of income, in such a case, the rate of tax which will be applicable to the SSE will be by default at 30% at maximum marginal rate. At 30%, it will be taxable. Also, applicable surcharge and health and education says at 4%. Taxability of casual income is under 56(2)(1b). Rate of tax is mentioned in section 115(bb). Also, you won't be allowed any deduction on such income. If you have incurred any related expenses on earning such an income, then no deduction is allowed. No loss can be set off. No deduction under chapter 6A is allowed. Also, if you have any unexhausted basic exemption limit, that also cannot be utilized against such earnings. So friends, as you can see, the message is clear. The government is trying to discourage such type of income, and accordingly, no expenditure reduction is allowed, no deduction under Chapter 6A is allowed, basic exemption limit is not allowed to be set off against such an income. So friends, on your screen, 56(2)(1b) is the relevant section. Casual income means income in the nature of winnings from lotteries, crossword puzzles, races including horse races, card games and other games of any sort of gambling, betting, etc. Such winnings are chargeable to tax at a flat rate of 30% plus surcharge if applicable plus health and education says as per section 115(bb). No expenditure or allowance can be allowed from such income. Deduction under chapter 6A is not allowable from such income. Basic exemption limit is also not permitted against such income. Correct? So friends, this was casual income. Taxability is as per 1B of subsection 2 of section 56. Next clause is clause 8 of subsection 2 of section 56, which is related to interest received from compensation or enhanced compensation where there is a compulsory acquisition of the property owned by the SSC. So whenever there is a compulsory acquisition, you will be paid certain compensation by the government. And if there is delay in making the payment of the compensation, then you are also eligible for an interest amount. The interest received is taxable under the head income from other sources, and the relevant clause is clause 8 of subsection 2 of section 56. And the income will be taxable on receipt basis, meaning irrespective of the method of accounting followed by the SSC, interest received from compensation or enhanced compensation will always be taxable on receipt basis only. And this is coming from section 145(b)(1). So, as per section 145, you are given an option for the income which is taxable under the head income from other sources. You are given an option that taxability can be based on the method of accounting regularly employed by the SSC. So here an option is given to the SSC as per section 145. Such an option is also available under profit and gains from business or profession. Also, if you see for salaries, it is taxable on receipt or due basis, whichever is earlier. So, meaning in other provisions of the Act, in other charging sections, you do not have such an option, wherein you have to tax an income based on what the provision is saying. Whatever the provision says, you have to implement it. Whatever the charging sections are saying, you have to tax it in that particular previous year. The option of method of accounting regularly employed by the SSC can be synced with the taxability is under the head income from other sources and profit and gains from business or profession. And this flexibility, this option is provided as per section 145 subsection 1. However, for interest received on compensation or enhanced compensation, only for this income, it has been specifically mentioned that you cannot exercise the option of method of accounting regularly employed. For such an interest income, it should be taxable based on receipt basis, based on cash basis. Fine. So it will be taxable in the year of receipt, and it could be possible that, you know, interest is generally paid to the assignee when there is delay in the compensation. So you can expect that during the previous year, 1920, you are bound to receive interest which could be more than 4 years, more than 3 years preceding the current previous year. So even income of previous year 1718, 1819, you will be receiving in 1920 because there has been delay in receiving compensation from the government, and accordingly interest is being paid to the SSC. And such an income which pertains to 1718, 1819 will be taxed on cash basis, will be taxed on receipt basis in the previous year in which it is received. Correct? So friends, on your screen, interest received on compensation, enhanced compensation, section 56(2)(8), clause 8, as per section 145(1), income chargeable under the head profit and gains of business or profession or income from other sources shall be computed in accordance with either cash or mercantile system of accounting regularly employed by the SSC. So as we have discussed, option is available to the SSC for the head profit and gains from business or profession and income from other sources, wherein the income can be taxed either on cash or mercantile system of accounting, meaning either cash or accrual basis of accounting, which is regularly followed by the SSC, can be implemented for such head of income. However, section 145(b)(1) provides that notwithstanding anything contained in section 145(1). So 145(b)(1) is overriding the provisions of the first para, which is 145(1). The interest received by an SSC on compensation or on enhanced compensation shall be deemed to be his income of the previous year in which it is received. So on receipt basis, the income will be taxable as per section 145(b)(1). Section 56(2)(8) provides that income by way of interest received on compensation or on enhanced compensation referred to in section 145(b)(1) shall be assessed as income from other sources in the year in which it is received. So friends, interest from enhanced compensation, interest from compensation or on enhanced compensation is to be read with, is as per section 56(2)(8), which is to be read with section 145(b)(1), wherein such interest will be taxable on receipt basis only in the year in which it is received. Also friends, on a related note, such an interest income will be allowed as deduction at the rate of 50% as per section 57, that we will be covering in subsequent slides as well. But on a related note, an SSC who is receiving interest, let's say in the previous year 1920 of the preceding years as well, any interest income received, a standard deduction of 50% is allowed as per section 57. Advance forfeited. 56 to 9. Advance forfeited means, let's say you are owner of a property, right? And you're trying to sell the property. Now you are in talk with a buyer and you have obtained a token money from the buyer. Let's say buyer wants to purchase the property and he has paid a token money of 50,000. Now, after 1 year, buyer comes and tells that he doesn't want to purchase the property. So the transaction hasn't materialized and he has received 50,000 as a token money. Now, the nature of the token money is always that it is not supposed to be paid back to the buyer. It becomes the income of the SSC, and the SSC, the owner of the property, is not bound to pay any money to the buyer. So this becomes an income of the SSC by default because the transaction hasn't taken place. So how to treat this income will be, you cannot treat that as an income from house property, right? Because you haven't earned any rental income from it, and no capital gains as well, because you haven't sold the property. There is no transfer of the capital asset. So in this case, before 1st of April 2014, this amount was adjusted against the cost of acquisition. Meaning, if after 5 years, the SSC is able to sold the property, so sale consideration 100 and cost of acquisition previously was 50. And the token money, let's say, is 10 rupees. So this token money, this advance forfeited amount, was adjusted against the cost of acquisition of the capital asset. So in a way, the treatment is like, either you add to the sale consideration, either the amount, since it's a benefit, it is either to be added to a sale consideration, or you decrease the cost of acquisition. Before 1st of April 2014, the treatment was, it was deducted from the cost of acquisition, correct? Now, with effect from 1st of April 2014, such advance forfeited is taxable under clause 2 of section 56, under clause 9 of subsection 2 of section 56, which is 56 to 9, advance forfeited, and it is specifically taxable as income from other sources. That is with effect from 1st of April 2014. On your screen, advance received and forfeited up to 31st of March 2014 has to be reduced from cost of acquisition while computing capital gains, since such advance would not have been subjected to tax under section 56 to 9. 56 to 9 came into existence with effect from 1st of April 2014. Only the advance received and forfeited on or after 1st of April 2014 would be subject to tax under section 56 to 9, correct? So, with effect from 1st of April 2014, the amount forfeited, the advance forfeited, is taxable in the hands of the SSC under the head income from other sources. Now friends, the next provision, the next clause, 56 to 11, compensation or any other payment received in connection with termination of his employment. So friends, this is a recent amendment wherein any compensation or other payment received by an employee, with any compensation received on account of employment where there is termination of the employment, will be taxable as income from other sources. And it should be that there is the payer and payee, the relationship between payer and payee is not that of employer-employee relationship. If there is employer and employee relationship, then the same will be taxable as profits in lieu of salary. The same will be taxable as income under the head salaries, income from salaries. Since there is no employer-employee relationship, if a person is receiving a payment on account of termination of the employment from a person other than employer, then there is a provision of taxability under the head income from other sources, which is under clause 11. On your screen, any compensation or any other payment due to or received by any person by whatever name called in connection with the termination of his employment or the modification of the terms and conditions relating thereto shall be chargeable to tax under this head. Correct? So, it could be due to or received, due or receipt basis by any person in connection with termination or modification of the terms and conditions of the employment. And the payment should be done by a payer who is not an employer. If he is an employer, then the same will be taxable under the head income from salaries. Correct? So it could be, you know, the nature of payment could be, let's say a director who is not an employee, not a whole-time director or non-executive director. Let's take an example wherein a payment is received by the director from the company. So here, generally, the director used to escape the payment, escape the taxability by saying that it is a capital receipt. Right? And since you can say capital receipt for taxability under the income tax law, it should be specifically provided. And there is absence of such specific provision. So, non-executive director is receiving payment from a company on account of termination of employment or modification of terms and conditions of the agreement, you can say. Right? So, in that scenario, and so mind you, the amount is always a huge amount. Any such payment to a non-executive director is huge amount, which runs, which is more than even 25 lakhs or which may touch even crores. So, such taxability was escaping assessment only because it was a capital receipt. Fine. So, under the head income from salaries, the same is provided as taxable as profits in lieu of salary. However, employer and employee relationship essential for this. So, even non-executive director was not taxable under the head income from salaries. So, this provision has been inserted under income from other sources, wherein whether it is a capital receipt or not, it will be taxable over here, and it doesn't matter now whether there is employer-employee relationship or not. If there is an employer-employee relationship, then the same will be taxable under the head income from salaries. If there is no employer-employee relationship, friends, it will be taxable under the head income from other sources. So, friends, by inserting this provision, the government, the legislature has tried to cover a loophole wherein a capital receipt by a non-executive director where there is no employer and employee relationship can be taxed under the head income from other sources under clause 11 of subsection 2 of section 56. So, friends, till now we have studied under clause 2 of subsection, under subsection 2 of section 56, clause 1b related to casual income, which is related to winnings from lotteries, horse races, card games, taxable at 30%, no deduction allowance allowed, no deduction under chapter 6 allowed, no basic exemption limit allowed, interest received on compensation or enhanced compensation is taxable on receipt basis in the year of receipt, and a standard deduction of 50% is allowed as per section 57. Advance forfeited is taxable in the hands of the receiver in the year in which it is received with effect from 1st of April 2014. It will be taxable under that income from other sources. And compensation received on termination or modification of terms and conditions of the employment in absence of employer and employee relationship, the same will be taxable under clause 11 of subsection 2 of section 56. Now, friends, the next clause pertaining to subsection 2 of section 56, wherein there are three pointers mentioned over here. Let's take one by one. First is employee's contribution received by the employer. As we have studied, discussed earlier, that you know, employee's contribution received by the employer is an obligation of the employer to pay to the respective fund within the respective act due date. Correct? And the applicable sections that we have discussed is as per section 2, clause 24, such an employee's contribution to a welfare scheme. Such an employee's contribution is an income of the employer. Till the time it is paid to the PF commissioner or to the fund, it will be treated as income of the employer SSE. And as per 36(1), deduction will be allowed to the SSE if the payment is before the due date of the respective act. Then a deduction of this employee's contribution will be allowed. So 100 rupees will be treated first as income, and then 100 rupees will be deducted if the payment is made within the due date as per section 36(1). Now friends, such income should be backed by a charging section, and the relevant charging section which taxes the employee's contribution is nothing but section 56. So whenever an employee's contribution is with the employer, then it is taxed under section 56 to read with section 2 clause 24. Correct? So subsection 2 section 56 says that employee's contribution will be treated as income in the hands of the employer SSE under section 56(2). And not only the provident fund account, but superannuation fund account or any other fund which is for employee's welfare is included. Correct? And thereafter, letting out of machinery or plant or furniture, income from letting out on hire of machinery, plant or furniture will be taxable under the head income from other sources, as well as if along with machinery, plant or furniture, building is also let out on hire, in which case the building is inseparable from the machinery, from the plant or furniture, then it will be taxable under the head income from other sources. Let's take an example. SSE is into the business of hotel, hotel chain, hotel business, and now he wants to sell the entire building of hotel only because the business is not going on smoothly. Now, the building, you can say, is attached. You want to sell the entire business. So, along with the furniture, along with lift and other machinery, plant or furniture, the building is also let out by the SSE. So, in such a case, income from letting out on hire of building, hotel building and furniture, along with lift and other public spaces, you can say that entire income from letting out on hire of building along with machinery, plant or furniture will be taxed under the head income from other sources. Vis-a-vis, if you have a house property, I'm trying to distinguish over here income from house property and income from other sources. So the example that we took was for hotel business, and the same will be taxable under the head income from other sources. Now what will be taxable under the head income from house property will be a building which is let out, and a house property which is a building along with furniture it is let out by the SSE. It will continue to be taxable under, it will continue to be taxable under the head income from house property, friends, right? So that continues. It's only that in case of specific example, wherein the example that we took, the entire hotel business is to be let out, the entire building is to be let out, in such a case it will be taxable under the head income from other sources, right? And it doesn't matter if different invoices are billed for rent of building and rent of machinery, plant or furniture. As far as it can be proved that, you know, building along with plant or furniture are inseparable, the SSE doesn't want to let out building and plant or furniture separately, and also they are inseparable. In such a case, any income from letting out of such building, plant or furniture will be taxable under the head income from other sources. Correct? On a screen, income chargeable under the head income from other sources only if, this word is important, only if not chargeable under the head profit and gains of business or profession. So if the SSE is not into the business of letting out, this should not be stock in trade. The hotel business which is the SSE into, if he would have been in the business of letting out of property on hire, then in such a case, the income would have been taxed under the head profit and gains from business or profession and not income from other sources. So the first condition which has been mentioned is income to be taxed under income from other sources is it should not be taxed under the head income, under the head profit and gains from business or profession. So the income will be chargeable under the head income from other sources, following income, only if not chargeable under the head profit and gains from business or profession. First, employee's contribution that we spoke, any sum received by an employer SSC from his employees as contributions to any provident fund, superannuation fund or any other fund for the welfare of the employees will be treated as income under the head income from other sources, and you can say till the time the same is paid to the respective fund, till the time it is paid to the PF commissioner, provident fund commissioner, or any other welfare fund commissioner. Income from letting out on hire machinery, plant or furniture, where letting out of buildings is inseparable from the letting out of machinery, plant or furniture, the income from such letting will be taxable under the head income from other sources, and the example that we took was SSC, which is into hotel business. So letting out of buildings is inseparable, correct? Next point is interest on securities. Interest on securities, mind you, securities mentioned over here. Let's understand first the meaning of securities. Securities mentioned over here are not shares. They are definitely not shares. Securities, the word security hasn't been defined under the Income Tax Act. You will have to move straightforward to the word, the term interest on securities has been defined under Section 2, Clause 28 as interest income from government securities, from government bonds. So you can say that it has a direct correlation with bonds, securities, deposits which have government connection, which are related to government, which are related to local authority, statutory body, and so on and so forth. So any interest on securities, bonds, deposits with, you can say, even post office saving bank account with local authorities, with statutory body, is nothing but any income, any interest income from such securities is nothing but interest on securities, and it is to be read with Section 10, Clause 15, wherein specific exemptions are provided where interest or any income is received from bonds, securities which are related to government, and if the same is not mentioned under Clause 15, Section 10, if the same is not mentioned under Section 10, then it will be taxable under the head income from other sources as interest on securities. Correct? So what we can do over here is, I will quickly go through Clause 15, Section 10 on your screen. I mean, it's a huge section and it is basically connected to government securities, local authority securities bonds. And as you go clause by clause, you will understand that it has a government connection, local authority connection. Correct? So better to read from the screen itself, as the same is covered in your syllabus and we will go through it quickly through the screen. So on your screen, friends, interest on securities is taxable under the head income from other sources and it is to be read along with clause 15 of section 10. However, the following interest income would be exempt under section 10.15. Income by way of interest, premium on redemption or other payment on notified securities, bonds, annuity certificates or other savings certificates, such interest, such income is exempt as per section 10.15. Correct? So it should be notified. Central government will notify the securities, bonds, certificates, interest from which is exempt, subject to such conditions and limits as may be specified in the notification. Interest on post office savings bank account would be exempt from tax to the extent of 3,500 and 7,000. 3,500 in the case of individual account, 7,000 in the case of joint account. And friends, this is related to post office saving bank account. The interest from such a saving bank account is exempt to the extent of 3,500 or 7,000. Clause B, interest payable by a public sector companies on certain specified bonds and debentures. So friends, interest is paid by a public sector company and the bonds and debentures are also specified, subject to conditions which the central government may specify by notification, including the condition that the holder of such bonds or debentures registers his name and holding with that company. Okay, additional condition. So basically you need to remember interest income from public sector companies and that too for specified bonds and debentures. In this regard, central government has specified tax-free bonds issued by India Infrastructure Company Limited and tax-free secured redeemable non-convertible bonds of the following companies. So India Infrastructure Company and IRFCL, which is Indian Railway Finance Corporation Limited, National Highways Authority of India, Rural Electrification Corporation Limited, Housing and Urban Development Corporation. As you can see, it has a government connection. Power Finance Corporation, Jawaharlal Nehru Port Trust, Dredging Corporation of India Limited, Ennore Port Limited, the Indian Renewable Energy Development Agency Limited. The interest from which would be exempt under this section, correct? So bonds issued by such companies which has been notified by central government will be exempt under section 10.15. Interest income from Government of India on deposit made by an employee of the central or state government or a public sector company in accordance with the scheme as may be notified. So this scheme is applicable only to central or state government employees wherein a deposit is made to the Government of India and which is as per the scheme notified by central government. Government of India, employees of state or central government or public sector company of the monies due to him on account of his retirement while on superannuation or otherwise. So basically interest income friends, interest payable by Government of India on the monies due to him on account of his retirement. Scheme is not applicable to non-government employees. So this scheme is only available to deposits made by central or state government. The term industrial undertaking means, friends, while we'll go through the provisions, all the provisions of clause 15, section 10, as per my reading, the provision which is related to industrial undertaking was applicable before 2016, I guess. For the previous year, if I see, this provision is no more applicable. However, in your syllabus, the definition of industrial undertaking has been discussed. Accordingly, we are also discussing at least the definition of industrial undertaking. However, under clause 15, section 10, you won't find any of the provisions which are related to industrial undertaking. The term industrial undertaking means any undertaking which is engaged in manufacture or processing of goods, manufacture of computer software, or recording of programs, or any disc, tape, perforated media, or any other information device, or the business of generation, or generation and distribution of electricity, or any other form of power, business of providing telecommunication services, so electricity, software, telecommunication services, mining, construction of ships, ship building, and ship breaking, operation of ships, aircrafts, correct? This is the definition of industrial undertaking or operation of rail systems. For the purpose of this clause, interest shall not include interest paid on delayed payment of loan or default if which is more than 2% per annum over the rate of interest payable in terms of such loan. So any interest payable which is related to delayed payment of loan or any kind of default, if you are paying any interest charges because of default or delayed payment of loan, such default charges in the form of interest won't be allowed as deduction. Anything in excess of 2% per annum will be disallowed. So interest shall not include more than 2% per annum. interest would include hedging transaction charges on account of currency fluctuation. And this is applicable for clause B that we have just discussed. Correct? Now friends, Bhopal gas victims, again an extension of clause 15, section 10, wherein the victims and interest income received by them will be exempt under subsection under clause 15 of section 10, wherein exemption in respect of interest on securities held by Welfare Commissioner, Bhopal Gas Victims, Bhopal, with Reserve Bank of India, any interest received by such a welfare commissioner who has maintained an account with RBI will be exempt under clause 15 of section 10. Subclause 5 of clause 15 of section 10, exemption has been extended to interest on deposits for the benefit of the victims of the Bhopal gas leak disaster. So friends, interest on deposit is also exempt and it should be for the benefit of the Bhopal gas victim. Such deposits can be held in such account with the RBI or with the public sector bank as the central government may notify in the official gazette. Interest on gold deposit, bond issued under the Gold Deposit Scheme 1999 or deposit certificates issued under the Gold Monetization Scheme 2015, which is notified by the central government. So friend, gold deposit bonds or certificates, deposit certificates. Interest on bonds issued by a local authority, again a government connection, a state pooled finance entity and specified by CG by notification in official gazette. State pooled finance activity means an entity which is set up in accordance with the guidelines for the pooled finance development scheme notified by the central government in the Ministry of Urban Development. So the entity is set up by guidelines for the pooled finance development scheme and which is notified by the central government. So friends, just to recap what we have studied in clause 10-15. Clause 15 of section 10 is the interest income, the premium on redemption or any payment from a notified securities bond certificates will be exempt under clause 15. Even interest on post office saving bank account is exempt with 3,500 from a single account. From a joint account, it is 7,000. Interest paid by public sector companies on specified bonds and debentures is exempt and the same should be notified by the central government. And the central government has notified India Infrastructure Company Limited, NHI, RECL, Indian Railway Finance Corporation, etc. The interest from such a bonds, such notified bonds, is exempt. Under clause 15 of section 10, interest paid by Government of India to the employees of central or state government on deposits made by such employees. The scheme is not applicable to non-government employees. The definition of industrial undertaking is related to manufacturing of goods, manufacturing of software, electricity, telecommunication, mining, construction of ships, shipbreaking, operation of ships, etc. Wherein interest shall not include any delayed payment interest, any default interest which is more than 2% per annum, and hedging transaction charges received on account of currency fluctuation is exempt. It will be included as part of the interest income. Bhopal gas victims, any interest received from an account from a security maintained by welfare commissioner will be exempt. Even interest on deposit is exempt and the account should be maintained with RBI or any public sector bank which is notified, approved by central government. Gold deposit scheme, interest from such a scheme, from bond certificate related to gold will be exempt. Interest on bonds related to local authority or pooled finance entity, state pooled finance entity will be exempt under clause 15. Accordingly, friends, in this regard, CG has specified tax-free pooled finance development bonds under pooled finance development fund scheme, Government of India, interest from which would be exempt under section 10-15, which is nothing but related to state pooled finance entity. Friends, this was a recap of clause 15 of section 10, wherein any interest income received from bonds, from notified bonds, securities, certificates, deposits will be exempt in the hands of the recipient under clause 15 of section 10. So friends, the next provision is related to key man insurance policy. We have studied this under the head income from salaries as well as under the head profit and gains from business or profession, wherein the company is insuring for the key persons of the company, right? And where the employer-employee relationship is missing, then the same can be taxed under the head income from other sources. So basically, the proceeds received from key man insurance policy, including bonus, is bound to be taxable. It's only that which head it will be taxable. It could be either income from salaries, profit and gains from business or profession, or income under the head, income from other sources. Correct? So, key man insurance policy, any sum received under the key man insurance policy, including the sum allocated by way of bonus, is chargeable under this head. If such income is not chargeable under the head, income under the head, profit and gains of business or profession or salaries. Correct? I mean, the basic criteria of taxability under the head income from other sources is that it should not be taxable in the preceding chapters, in preceding sections. Accordingly, since key man insurance policy proceeds, including bonus, has not been taxed under the head profit and gains from business or profession or under the head salaries, the same is taxable accordingly under the head income from other sources. So any sum received, including bonus, not chargeable under profit and gains and salaries. That is, if such sum is received by any person other than the employer who took the policy and the employee in whose name the policy was taken. Correct? Residual income. Residual income is nothing but the income which is supposed to be taxed, which is revenue in nature, right? Which is revenue in nature and which is supposed to be taxed, and the same is not taxable under the preceding sections, preceding chapters, then in such a case, the same will be taxable under the head income from other sources. Any income chargeable to tax under the Act but not falling under any other head of income shall be chargeable to tax under this head, which is nothing but a residual category. Example, salary received by MPs, MLAs. In this, friends, you will see there is no employer and employee relationship, though the term salary, but the remuneration or compensation which is received by MPs, MLAs from the government is not out of employer-employee relationship, and accordingly, such income is bound to be taxed, and it is taxed under the head income from other sources. So, MPs and MLAs salary will not be chargeable to income tax under the head salaries, but will be chargeable as income from other sources under section 56. Just an example of residual income, wherein salary to MPs and MLAs is not falling under the preceding chapters, under the preceding sections, and accordingly, it is subject to tax under the head income from other sources. Also, a CBDT circular has been issued in 2015 related to interest which is received by bank on non-SLR securities. So, any such interest received will be a business income of the banks as per the CBDT circular issued in November 2015. Interest from non-SLR securities of banks, CBDT White Circular number 18 dated 2nd of November 2015 clarified that the investments made by a banking concern are part of the business of banking. Therefore, the income arising from such investments is attributable to the business of banking, falling under the head profit and gains from business or profession. So why this circular, CBDT has clarified that any such investments of the banks is nothing but interest income from such investments is nothing but taxable under the head profit and gains from business or profession. Now, friends, we have concluded subsection 2 of section 56. Now, moving on to section 59 and section 145. Section 59 is nothing but taxability of deemed income, which is similar to subsection 1 of section 41 of the profit and gains from business or profession, wherein, if you remember, there was a clause wherein any benefit in the nature of remission or cessation of any trading liability will be taxable as deemed income in the hands of the SSC in the year of receipt, and such receipt will be taxable even if the business is no more into existence. So that provision under subsection 1 of section 41 will be applicable under the head income from other sources as well, same provisions will be applicable under section under the head income from other sources as well under section 59. So the crux of the provision was you have taken a benefit by taking a deduction of a particular expenditure of a particular tax, right? Now taxes have been refunded to you, or the liability subsequently in subsequent years you have received certain amount from the liability which was written off in the books of accounts. Now friends, in section 41 it was taxable under net profit and gains from business or profession. If there is no business connection to such a benefit, if there is no business connection to such a remission or cessation liability benefit, in such a case, since the same is not taxable under the head profit and gains from business or profession, the same will be taxable under the head income from other sources under section 59, and it will be taxed even if the business is no more in existence. It will be taxed in the year of receipt of such a benefit. And generally, you will see many of the provisions under the head income from other sources have been borrowed from previous provisions. You will find many such sections. Section 59 is obviously one of those examples. Also, section 57 and section 58. Section 57, which is related to amount which are allowed as deduction, and section 58 is related to amounts which are not allowed as deduction while computing the income under the head income from other sources. So under section 57-58 also we will find provisions which has been borrowed from previous provisions of the act, or provisions which you already know, and since due to some criteria they are not falling under the previous headers, they are falling under the head income from other sources. On your screen, deemed income chargeable to tax, section 59. The provisions of section 41(1) are made applicable so far as may be to the computation of income under this head, section 41(1). Accordingly, where a deduction has been made in respect of a loss, where a deduction has been made in respect of a loss, expenditure or liability, and subsequently any amount is received or benefit is derived, so a deduction is already taken in the books of accounts, and subsequently any amount is received or benefit is derived in respect of such expenditure incurred or loss or trading liability allowed as deduction, then it shall be deemed as income in the year in which the amount is received or the benefit is accrued. Correct? So in the year of receipt, it will be deemed as income of the SSC as per section 59. Provisions are similar to subsection 1 of section 41. Method of accounting, section 145. As we have discussed earlier, while studying the taxability of interest on enhanced compensation on account of compulsory acquisition, the interest received on the same is taxable on receipt basis, wherein it is an exception to section 145 subsection 1, wherein the interest is taxable on receipt basis. The method of accounting followed by the SSC is to be ignored for the taxability of interest. That is what we studied under clause under subsection 2 of section 56 for taxability of interest under the head income from other sources. Now that method of accounting is elaborated under section 145, wherein an option is given to the SSC, wherein for taxability of income under the head income from other sources can be taxed as per method of accounting regularly employed by the SSC. Correct? So if in the books of accounts, let's say a company is following a mercantile system of accounting as per Companies Act, and now the SSC for income tax purpose is allowed to follow a mercantile system for income from other sources also, for taxability of income under the head income from other sources as well as profit and gains, both the heads of income are allowed to follow any method of accounting regularly employed by the SSC. So in this way you can say the books of accounts will be in sync with the income tax law computation. The computation of income and tax liability will be on par with the books of accounts, the entries which has been booked in the books of accounts of the SSC. Correct? So friends, subsection 1 gives an option to the SSC for income under the head profit and gains and income under the head income from other sources. Subsection 2 empowers central government to prepare and issue computation disclosure standards. Income computation and disclosure standards, which are ICDS, which we have discussed under the topic profit and gains from business or profession, wherein central government is empowered to issue ICDS, which are related to how to compute income and what are the disclosure requirements, which are similar to, you can say, Ind AS accounting standards for accounting purpose, right? And for this purpose, central government has indeed notified 10 ICDS, which is to be followed by a company which is following a mercantile system of accounting. If a company is following a mercantile system of accounting, entity is following a mercantile system of accounting, accrual system of accounting, then in such a scenario, ICDS are to be adhered to by such an entity, by such a company. Correct? And last provision is exception. Exception is such ICDS provisions are not applicable to individuals or HUF to whom tax audit is not applicable. Tax audit under section 44AB is not applicable to individual HUF. If yes, then ICDS disclosure requirement, computation requirements are not applicable to such an individual HUF. Apart from that, it is applicable to each and every entity, each and every company. On your screen, method of accounting, section 145, income chargeable under the head income from other sources has to be computed in accordance with cash or mercantile system of accounting regularly employed by the SSC. So here an option is given to the SSC, subsection 1. Subsection 2, central government is empowered to notify in gazette from time to time income computation and disclosure standards to be followed by any class of SSCs or in respect of any class of income. Income computation and disclosure standards to be followed by certain SSCs, by notified SSCs or by notified class of income. Accordingly, central government has notified 10 ICDS to be followed by all SSCs following the mercantile system of accounting for the purpose of computation of income chargeable under the head profit and gains or income from other sources. 10 ICDS are applicable to SSCs who are following mercantile system of accounting under the head profit and gains and income from other sources. Above provision is not applicable to an individual or HUF whom tax audit is not applicable. Correct? So friends, this concludes other provisions wherein we have discussed section 145 method of accounting regularly employed by the SSC. An option is given to an SSC for the purpose of taxability, for the purpose of computing income under that income from other sources, and also 10 ICDS which are notified by central government applicable to entity company following a mercantile system of accounting, deemed income which is similar to section 41 subsection 1 of the profit and gains from business or profession, residual income, any income which is not falling under the previous heads of income will be taxed under that income from other sources. Example, salary received by MPs, MLAs is not taxable under that income from salary because there is no employer-employee relationship, and accordingly the same will be taxable under the head income from other sources. Circular that we discussed was interest from non-SLR securities of banks is income from profit and gains from business or profession. Demand insurance policy is taxable under that income from other sources provided the same is not taxable under the previous heads. So friends, this concludes the other provisions part of subsection 2 of section 56, and along with the other provisions of subsection 2, we have also studied section 145 and section 59. Thank you.